Hey guys, we're back. I know we've already done a couple of videos about the mower, but we keep continuing to get questions and we really want to make sure that we're helping you guys. That's the whole point of a lot of these videos. So we're going to kind of tag team on this a little bit. I'm going to show you the different components and how they connect and things like that. And then he's going to expand on each of those and explain the purpose and his decisions behind each of the choices that he made. And hopefully we've answered pretty much all of your questions at this point. I know that there are tons of you with tons of amazing suggestions. Just know that this is really and truly a work in progress. And we're really grateful for all the questions and comments and positive feedback and all of that. So thank you guys very, very much for everything. And let's just get into it. Ready?
Ready.
All right. So one of the first things that we've done since the last video is we did a quick connect for the battery as well as a quick connect for the charger.
And the reason I use a quick disconnect for the battery is if I'm in the middle of a mow, say I'm mowing the backyard where we have a lot of trees and bushes and I run out of battery life, I can do a quick swap of the battery for a replacement battery, do the quick connect, switch them out, and finish my job. So in my parking spot where I park the mower in between mows, I have a automatic battery charger always plugged into the wall. So whenever I park it, I plug in the quick connect for the battery charger and it does a trickle charge of the battery throughout the week to help preserve its longevity. And whenever I'm ready to use it, I just unplug the charger. It's at its optimal battery voltage, ready to go.
So just like the last video, there's a 60 amp fuse and switch, and that cuts the power for the motor driver.
The quick connector, straight from the battery, has a positive and negative lead off of it. The positive lead goes through a 60 amp fuse. The fuse is in place for if there's a short in the wiring somewhere, it'll pop this fuse and turn everything off, hopefully without damaging any components. I also have the negative runs through this toggle switch. The toggle switch lets me turn on and off the motor driver whenever I want to use it.
So this looks complicated, but it's actually not that bad. The middle two terminals are power from the battery. The left two right here are for the left motor, and the right two right here are for the right motor.
This motor driver is designed to drive two motors. It has a left channel and a right channel for motors. The motors have a positive and negative lead off of each one. You just plug them into the positive negative terminal of the left motor and positive negative terminal of the right motor indicated on the motor driver connectors. The motor driver takes the battery input and gives the power to the appropriate motor based on the signal from the remote receiver.
So you notice we have two small sensor leads and those read voltage from the battery. They also power this step down converter. This step down converter converts 12 volts to 5 volts for accessories.
The step down converter is here so that I have an alternate power source other than the motor driver. You don't necessarily need the step down converter. You can power the remote receiver directly from the motor driver, but if something were to happen to the motor driver, if it were to short out, or if it were to experience flyback voltage, which can sometimes happen if you have large motors going forward and then all of a sudden you stop giving them power, sometimes the voltage will spike back through the system and short out the motor driver momentarily. And then it will also short out the remote receiver, which then won't be able to interpret signals from your transmitter, which could lead to it getting out of control. So I like to have a separate power source for the remote receiver, separate from the motor driver.
This right here is the remote receiver. It receives signal from the transmitter. This is the remote transmitter. So channels 1 and channel 2 for the remote receiver are plugged into channels 1 and 2 of the motor driver through the white wires there.
The input for the motor driver is just a two-channel input. It's S1 and S2. It receives signal directly from the remote receiver. I only use the white wire from channel 1 on the remote receiver to S1 on the motor driver and channel 2 of the remote receiver to S2 of the motor driver. Channel 1 and channel 2 of the remote receiver correspond to channel 1 and channel 2 of the remote transmitter. The left stick is channel 3 and channel 4. This is a fly sky transmitter, which means it's really designed for an airplane. So this stick
doesn't have the spring back centering action that this one does. So I don't use the left stick.
Power in for the remote receiver is powered by the step down converter, or it could be powered by the motor driver if you didn't have a step down converter.
Another reason to have the step down converter is that it can output 3 amps to power things like servos and other actuators you may have in your system. So if you're using your remote receiver to power, say, a steering module or some high powered servos, something to lift or push, you're going to want more power than this motor driver can output. So it's better to have a separate dedicated power source for that. I just have this one plug with just the power and ground lines connected. Plug it into the VCC port on the remote receiver, and that feeds power to the remote receiver and outputs power from this to any servos that are connected to it. And like I said, this does not have to be hooked to the step down converter. You can instead hook those wires to the motor driver here, positive and negative, and power directly from the motor driver without this step down converter here at all.
Servos for the throttle and kill switch are plugged into channels 5 and 6 of the remote receiver.
Once the servos are mounted, they have a 3-wire connector coming off of them. All you may need to use is a servo extension wire like this one. It has a male and a female end. Just connect them so that they match, and it will extend long enough to plug directly into your remote receiver. Since this is 3 wires, it gets its signal, power, and ground from the remote receiver directly. So whatever power source the remote receiver is plugged into is the power that will power the servos directly. Since channel 1 and channel 2 are the right stick of the remote transmitter, channel 3 and channel 4 are the left stick of the remote transmitter. I chose channels 5 and channel 6 as my 2 servo channels. You can replace the receiver with this 10 channel receiver so that you can hook up more servos and lights and other doodads later on down the road. For my throttle servo, I'm using channel 5, so all I have to do is plug this in so that the signal wire is on the top. Plug this directly into the channel 5 port like that.
Based on the remote transmitter that you have, you will need to look into your manual to see how to get to these settings and navigate into the aux channel settings so that you can set which switches go to which channels. So you can see I have channel 5 is VRB, which is this one, and then channel 6 is SWD, which is switch D, which is this one.
The sensor for the battery voltage is plugged into the serial port of the remote receiver.
I also have a sensor on these 2 terminals that leads to this fly sky voltage sensor. It plugs into the sensor serial port of the remote receiver. When this is plugged in, the voltage sensor will feed the battery voltage information back to the remote transmitter so that you can read the battery voltage on the screen of the transmitter as you're mowing.
So that's it for the connections for the remote receiver and the motor driver. So like in the last video, the throttle servo is controlled by the right knob of the remote transmitter. Since last video, we've added on a kill switch servo, and that's controlled by this button right here on the remote transmitter. We've also added in a failsafe, so if the transmitter loses power, then it automatically shuts off the mower.
For the failsafe settings, you'll want to go into your transmitter's settings. On the failsafe settings, I set my channel 6, which is my kill switch servo, to negative 100, which is all the way off this. So if I wanted it to be all the way on, I would set that. If I wanted it to be all the way off, I would set that. So whenever my transmitter loses power, it will go to off by default. Then I have to hold cancel to save, because that makes sense. As for the next build, I think I'm going to replace the fuse and switch with a single circuit breaker, 100 amp circuit breaker. I know now that the Sabertooth dual 25 amp motor driver requires a 100 amp fuse, not a 60 amp fuse. I haven't had an issue. So for me, the 60 amp is working, but I will replace this with a 100 amp circuit breaker, which has a physical switch and a fuse type circuit breaker built in. So that'll handle both of these with one device that I can switch on and off. I have also been asked if I want to cover all of this with plastic or a box or something. I do and I don't. I don't want to because this motor driver does produce a lot of heat. When it's been driving around the yard for a while, especially in the sun, it produces a lot of heat. I don't want to have to deal with heat by putting fans or this or that. I prefer this to be just out in the open so I can get maximum airflow. It does sometimes get grass and pine needles and stuff in the motor driver's PCB. I haven't had an issue with it shorting out or causing any issues. Usually when I get home and park it, I just hit it with the leaf blower real quick, blow all that stuff out. As long as it's not wet, it won't really be an issue, but it could. So it may be lowering the life expectancy of this motor driver by having it open and having it sometimes get leaves and debris in there. But for me, it's not really an issue. Although I do never plan to mow when the leaves are wet or the grass is wet, simply just for traction. If this thing got stuck out in the yard, there's no way I'd be able to go out and get it. So I just avoid mowing when it's possibly going to be wet or muddy out at all.
All right, guys, so that's it for this video. I hope this helps. And if you have any questions, please let me know in the comments below. Feel free to email me as well. And as always, if you like this video, please let us know in the comments too. Make sure you like and subscribe. And you guys have a great week, and we will talk to you soon. Bye, guys.